Hello again, everybody. I'm Jim Lampley. Very shortly to be joined at ringside by Andre Ward and Max Kellerman. Tremendous thrill for us tonight to be celebrating 1,000 prize fights on the air at HBO. As mentioned, the preliminary bout, which we'll be introducing in just a moment, is the 1,000th fight. And then the main event of the evening, Timothy Bradley against unbeaten Jesse Vargas, will be prize fight number 1,001 on HBO. Bradley, a surprisingly heavy favorite over Vargas, who's unbeaten to this point in his career and has 10 consecutive decision victories coming into the fight. But before we get to see Bradley and Vargas in the ring, we'll be looking at a product of the Mexican Olympic team, one of the best-looking young amateurs to come out of Mexico in the past several years, and now a rising prospect at 126 pounds. His name is Oscar Valdez, originally from here in the United States, in Nogales. Grew up with his father in Mexico. That's how he was on the Mexican Olympic team, fighting the prototypical kind of southpaw opponent at this stage of his career, veteran Ruben Tamayo. Let's take a look at the tail of the tape now for Oscar Valdez against Ruben Tamayo. And you see the two-year age advantage for Valdez. He's only 24, but he's giving up an inch and a half in height, an inch and a half in arm length measured from the armpit to the end of the fist, a half pound in weight at yesterday's weigh-in, and unofficially 2.5 pounds tonight in terms of functional working advantage for Ruben Tamayo, who unofficially weighs 138 to 135 and a half for Oscar Valdez. Let's go to ring announcer Lupe Contreras to get the evening started.
Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you all to the StubHub Center, Carson, California, for another edition of HBO's World Championship Boxing, proudly being brought to you by Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated, and being sponsored by La Cerveza Tecate con Carácter. Tonight's bouts are being sanctioned by the California State Athletic Commission. Commission Chair is John Carvelli. Executive Officer is Andy Foster. This is our co-featured bout of the evening, scheduled for a limit of 10 rounds in the featherweight division. The three judges are Jerry Cantu, Thomas Taylor, and Zachary Young. The man in charge, referee Rey Corona. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, he enters the ring weighing white with gold trim. When he stepped on the scale, he weighed in at an official 128 pounds. And in 32 pro bouts, he maintains a record of 23 victories against 5 defeats, 4 draws, and 15 of those victories coming by way of KO. Fighting out of Ciudad Obregón, Sonora, Mexico, Ruben Canelito Tamayo. His opponent across the ring in the red corner, wearing black with white. When he stepped on the scale, he weighed in at an official 127 and one half pounds. In the summers of 2008 and 2012, he proudly represented El Tricolor at the Beijing and London Olympic Games. And now he enters the ring, an undefeated professional with 15 victories, 14 of those victories coming by way of KO. Puro Nogales, Sonora, Mexico, Oscar Valdez.
My piece. Come on. Mira, aquí está bien. Escúchame. This is good right here. Touch gloves. God bless.
All right, last week we saw Verdejo, one of the best prospects in the game, Puerto Rican fighter, came up through the amateur ranks the same time that we're now going to see Valdez, maybe the best Mexican prospect in the game. They're within spitting distance of each other's weight classes. You're going to get to compare the two, Verdejo last week, Valdez right now.
And of course, a third contemporary of theirs as a featherweight amateur and also a lightweight amateur was Vasily Lomachenko, also promoted by the same promoter. So we could at some point see something like a round robin emerging among Valdez
of Mexico, Verdejo, Puerto Rico, and Lomachenko of Ukraine, three of the most prized young prospects in the sport at that weight level. Andre Ward, southpaw against conventional fighter. Valdez is known to be selective, but highly effective with his accurate power punching. What do you see early on?
Well, not much. Both fighters are trying to gauge distance and gauge range, and Valdez let us know that he had great sparring for this fight, good straight right there, which is what you want to do if you're a right-hander against a southpaw. And right now, these fighters are just trying to, once again, gauge range and just see who's going to get that positioning.
Early on, it looks as though Valdez wants to use two very frequently used weapons in this situation by the conventional fighter against the southpaw, straight right hand up the middle, left hook to the body following up.
And he's being very patient right now. He's got 10 rounds. He's got a lot of time. Nice left hook right there. And he's doing what he has to do right now.
Like the way Valdez just used his shoulder and turned his head simultaneously, Andre, and the right hand glanced harmlessly off the shoulder.
Yeah, he's very poised for being a fighter who only has 16 fights. He has great pedigree, two-time Mexican Olympian. And even as an amateur, he was known for having a pro style, and you can see that here.
Whistling right hand just then.
Tamayo has had a couple of knockout losses recently, knocked out in two of his last five fights, including the most recent one by Jesus Cuellar. And at this level of opposition, even though he may look physically like an interesting match for Valdez, you expect Valdez's accurate punching eventually to take his measure.
Tamayo told us his best punch, and his trainer told us best punch is his right hook. But when he throws the jab, it's almost like a WWE wrestler. So, you know, he picks that right foot up and puts it down as he throws the jab like a wrestler would.
And for Valdez, who's experienced and seasoned, he's going to see that coming every day of the week. Just missed a big right hand right there, Valdez.
Sophisticated amateurs and seasoned professionals can read the feet of their opponents. Valdez, if he reads Tamayo's feet, should be able to time him with a power shot as the fight goes on.
Work on it.
Had his feet on top of Valdez's feet, so that's a trip rather than a knockdown.
Punch,
oh, my goodness. Referee's going to call that a knockdown.
Six.
And that will make it a little bit more interesting as we go to the second round following what was chosen as a knockdown but appeared to us, or at least to my eyes, to be a tangling of the feet.
Precisely because of that, you've got to keep your left foot on the outside, okay? Why? Right, you see what happens? But relax, nothing's a problem. Relax. He felt your power? Yeah, good. So get him ready. Touch him first and then hard, okay? You good? All right, now practice the 1-2. The 1-2.
Here we see how the knockdown was set up for Matayo. He steps on the foot, it's coming up right here, of Valdez. Lands a shot at the same time, and that's what caused the knockdown, as well as a trip right there. So it was a punch and it was a slip at the same time, or at least their feet got tangled, and the referee called it a knockdown.
If it counts as a landed punch by CompuBox count, it would have been one of three punches that Tamayo landed in the round. Whereas Oscar Valdez was seen to have thrown 28 punches in the round and landed 16 of them. Very selective, low punch output, something we've been seeing recently from Valdez in his fight. 16 out of 28, meaning that he landed 57% of his punches in the first round.
Valdez's corner said, that's why we want your lead foot on the outside. When a southpaw fights a right-handed fighter who has their foot positioned on the outside, that guy's usually in a position to punch. But oftentimes we see their feet tangled as they jockey for that position and step forward with their punches. And that was clearly a trip.
Straight left hand landing for Valdez as he waited to throw the punch until Tamayo's head was in exactly the right position. Valdez with a lot of incentive in this second round after having been the victim of that shock knockdown at the end of round one. Valdez seems to have come out in round two wanting to make his mark with some heavy artillery early on, Andre.
That's what you want to see from Valdez. You don't want him to get too far away from the game plan where he leaves himself open, but he wasn't happy about the knockdown, and he's a young fighter, and now he's showing you that I'm stepping it up, and this guy should not be in the ring with me, and that's why you see the big shots coming. But to Max's point, yes, it was a trip, but it was also a punch, so it's a tough call.
I thought he went down as much from the force of his own left hook landing because the feet were tangled up.
Tough call in the moment for the ref.
Yeah.
He's not privy, obviously, to replays like we are.
The call is designed to make our evening more interesting by putting Valdez behind 10-8 at the end of the first round.
And it's not the same thing as recovering from an actual knockdown, but you do like to see how a young fighter deals with the idea that maybe it puts him behind in the fight and he has to prove something to his opponent.
Valdez is trying to square up now and land a big left hook on Tamayo, just like that.
Remember, it was Tamayo's right hook. That's
so interesting to watch Valdez's patience. Valdez has it in his mind he wants to throw a particular combination. If he doesn't have exactly the condition he wants to throw the second punch in the combination, he'll pause with his body held in the position in which he finds itself after the first punch and wait for the moment to throw the second one.
Yeah,
and that's remarkable poise, Andre.
Great timing and great range, great understanding of his range, and a great distance from Tamayo. He's seasoned. He's a two-time Olympian. He's only got 16 fights, but he seems like he's more seasoned than just those 16 fights.
Well, this is what happens when you have 300 amateur fights. And Valdez, by his count, says that he has 304 amateur fights, of which he won 277.
Good shot from Valdez.
He's landing very solid straight punches here in the second round. It was an excellent round for Oscar Valdez. July 25, Sergey the Crusher Kovalev, fresh off his knockout win over Jean Pascal in one of this year's best fights, takes on Najib Mohammadi. Also that night, the aforementioned Pascal returns to the ring, matching up with Unieski Gonzalez. And there's the Crusher with the jack-o'-lantern grin, which has been his trademark at ringside every time he comes to a fight. Very few people appear to be having more fun at the fights than Sergey Crusher Kovalev.
I've got to tell you what you're doing wrong, okay? Yes, it's okay, okay.
Okay.
Keep throwing punches, and you're on the inside, and you're not throwing, so you got to throw. He's hurt, you hurt him, so you got to throw. Come on, be lively. Three punches, come on, that's it.
Tamayo's trainer, Manuel Baldenegro, urging him to throw more. Tamayo in the second round by CompuBox numbers was 6 of 23. Valdez was 20 of 39. That means in two rounds so far, CompuBox has counted Valdez throwing 68 and landing 36. You don't often see that kind of accuracy. Quick left hook lands again for Valdez.
To your point, Jim, you see Valdez right there. He didn't get the left hook he wanted initially. He paused. He waited for Tamayo to open up, and then he landed another left hook in the right hand. So
exactly the
this
point.
Young kid has got a lot of pedigree, a lot of poise at his age right now. I like what I see from Valdez.
Yeah, the pausing in mid-combination, holding the position, timing it perfectly, and getting in the second, that looks like the kind of thing that Rigondo or Lomachenko would do.
You can't
guys
teach
with
that.
Enormous skill.
You can't teach that.
Excellent combination there. Andre, what's your take on the Monica Seles style grunt when a guy throws a punch? Very few fighters do it, and I'm wondering if those who do may be telegraphing their shots to a certain degree.
Not necessarily, because a lot of guys, they'll do it as they're landing a punch, not necessarily before they throw a punch. So if that helps him breathe, if that helps him release, you know, his air the proper way, then so be it. If a guy uses it excessively and he's kind of tipping a guy off, that's another thing. But it looks like Valdez is doing it as he's landing a punch, so it's hard to tip his opponent off. And even if he did tip him off, I don't think Tamayo can do much about it at this point. Good shot right there from Valdez. But Tamayo, to his credit, is taking some monstrous shots to the head. Will probably benefit Valdez to go to the body and bring those big shots back to the head to see if he gets a reaction from Tamayo.
Round three of a scheduled 10. Much of the crowd here, Mexican-American, so you expect that, you know, they're very pro Oscar Valdez in this fight. Body shots by Valdez, just as Andre Ward had prescribed earlier. He's landing solidly to the head. Tamayo's taking those shots very well. So it makes sense to mix in the body, set him up a little bit more.
Valdez has obviously decided he doesn't have a lot to worry about coming back at him, but again, he's in with a guy who apparently his money punch, his bread and butter, is the right hook. So that's one punch he really should be looking out for as he steps in with these combinations and these one-twos.
Valdez is breaking Tamayo down at the moment.
Coming up next, our main event, Timothy Bradley, who has not had a win since December of 2013 against Juan Manuel Marquez. Two fights last year, a draw against Diego Chavez and a loss to Manny Pacquiao. And there's Jesse Vargas, who comes in with 10 consecutive decision victories. Some of them were exceptionally close, but he's been getting the benefit of the doubt every time out.
A little bit more, son, a little bit more, because he's winning the fight because he's throwing more punches. Not because he's hitting you, he's throwing more punches. Come on, son, you gotta throw more. That's why we work. So throw a lot of punches. Or throw. When you're on the inside, lift him up. Lift him up with the uppercut on the left. Lift him, all right? Let's go.
Combi box numbers in round three. Valdez 28 out of 56, still landing 50% or more of his punches in every round. Tamayo 9 out of 49. 24 of Valdez's 28 landed punches were power shots. Only stands to reason he wouldn't use the jab all that much against a southpaw opponent, particularly when it's as easy as it has been for him to land his straight right hand down the pipe and his left hook to the body. And look how he resets his feet to set up the straight right hand once again. Harold, how do you have it through three?
Okay, Jim, I think Oscar Valdez caught up with Ray Corona's bad call in the first round. I got a 2-1. Oscar Valdez, in points, I got an even 28-28 because of the fact that I gave an extra point to Ruben Tamayo for the knockdown. You know, the judges really should go along with the referee's call no matter what. So I've got it even in points. But I got to tell you, Jim, this Oscar Valdez hits so hard. He sets his feet and he drives his punches right through Tamayo's guard. It's incredible. I mean, he really is landing hard shots. I give Tamayo all the credit in the world, you know, for still standing. But it's just a matter of time. 2-1, Oscar Valdez.
Particularly when the ref blows the call, I think that at best you give the guy an even round if you insist on giving him the extra point for the knockdown because the ref called it officially. And he didn't win the round otherwise, which he did not. I would call that first round even in that case.
And one advantage Oscar Valdez will have in building an audience for himself here in the United States, different from virtually every other Mexican star we've recently seen, Valdez speaks English.
Flawless
English. Spoken English ever since he was a child.
Yeah, you wouldn't know in which country he was born listening to him speak. He speaks very good English.
That's going to help him in his relationship with the American audience.
And look, this fight is not about whether or not Valdez wins. Of course, he's supposed to win. And he's supposed to look good. But he's on TV, and the question is, how good? Is he capturing boxing fans' imagination, making them think that this is another kid who's on his way to being a star, and suddenly a star-loaded division, Lomachenko, Nicholas Walters, and others?
Well, you can't look at a Mexican featherweight at this moment in time without considering how he compared to the three great Mexican featherweights of the preceding generation, Eric Morales, Marco Antonio Barrera, Juan Manuel Marquez. All of them ultimately graduated up to 140, or in Marquez's case, all the way to welterweight, but they began their career as featherweights and basically had featherweight styles.
Yeah, and junior featherweights, and it's an unfair expectation to put on a young rising prospect, but it is the expectation nonetheless. You're right. That's what the fans, and especially the Mexican-American and Mexican fight fans and fans of the lighter weight divisions, have grown accustomed to.
Many Mexican boxers turn pro at an early age to escape lives of poverty. Not the case for 24-year-old Oscar Valdez. This prospect delayed his professional debut for a shot at amateur glory.
My name is Oscar Valdez. I was born in Nogales, Sonora. When I was little, they typically went to Tucson. And when I was 11 years old, we went back to Mexico, my father and me. My father took me to the gym when I was 8. Ever since then, I put the first gloves on and had my first fight. I fell in love with the sport. For me, I consider myself one of the best amateur boxers in history. I had a lot of good tournaments. I'm the first Mexican fighter to become world champion in the youth. I went to Central American Games, the Pan Am Games. And I'm the first Mexican that went to 2 Olympic Games. And that opened the doors for me now as a professional. It's very important for me for this fight. I'm gonna have to prove who Oscar Valdez is. This is a great opportunity for me to show who I am.
There is a lot to like in young Oscar Valdez, trained by Manuel Robles, managed by veteran Frank Espinoza, whom we've seen with many terrific fighters over the years. Espinoza from here in Southern California. Valdez still landing more than 50% of his power shots in this fight.
For Valdez, he's pretty much hit Tamayo with everything in the book right now. Tamayo takes a good shot. He's a veteran, he's been there before. Valdez wants to try to set up those big shots like you mentioned earlier, Jim, behind the jab. He wants to blind Tamayo and then throw the big shots and see if he gets a different kind of reaction. And these are things that young fighters on the way up have to learn. As you see the veteran Tamayo, he's taking it and he's trying to give it. He's not, you know, as successful as Valdez by far offensively, but he's still giving a good effort and you gotta respect that.
In this round so far, Tamayo's landed 2 long left hands on Valdez from range, from distance.
And in the 2 previous rounds, he landed that right hook that you mentioned earlier several times as well.
Really fascinating to watch Valdez, how he sets and resets his feet and uses his feet to get into the right position to throw power shots. For many power punchers, it's just as important what they do with their feet as what they do with their hands. Watch guys like Kovalev and Golovkin, who are making big waves as power punchers right now. They don't throw until they're ready to breathe on the opponent. They get themselves right up close before they're going to launch a punch.
Yeah, these days you don't see a lot of fighters with great feet. A lot of fighters got great hands, but great feet is a lost art, and to see Valdez changing angles and moving around is very refreshing to see from a young fighter.
One thing he could be doing with his hands, Valdez, is something that Lomachenko and Golovkin are very good at, Jim, I think, which is varying the speed and the force of their shots. Valdez looks like he wants everything to land with authority, and maybe that's one of the reasons that his opponent is still there, because he's not surprised with anything. Every punch is landing with the same kind of force.
And as the veteran Tamayo is, he can compute that and brace for it and then take the shot like we're talking about here.
Tamayo with 32 professional fights coming in, nearly twice as many, well, actually more than twice as many as Valdez. So there is a difference in experience in terms of the number of times they've been in the ring, how many rounds they've fought.
A lot of times for a young fighter, they want to work harder and not smarter. And this is a case where Valdez should work smarter and not harder. Come behind the jab, slow your pace just enough, place those shots, and try to blind the veteran and then hit him with a shot he doesn't see and see what happens.
Tamayo gets in a straight left hand. Momentarily drives Valdez back into the ropes. Valdez fires back, 3 or 4 solid shots in return. And we're halfway through the fight. August 11, it's the return of the hugely popular HBO Sports Hard Knocks. Join J.J. Watts and the Houston Texans for behind-the-scenes access during training camp for 5 of the hottest, hardest weeks of their lives. See who makes the team, who doesn't, and who winds up in the starting lineup coming Tuesdays only on HBO. This just in, J.J. Watt will make the team.
Right now, you gotta get in. You gotta get close. You gotta get close. Stay in. All right, you gotta switch it up. Get close. Get inside to the body. All right. You can touch it to the body and then the shot over the top. Don't open up and go over the top. Get to the body and then over the top. You gotta get in. Get to
here
the spot.
Here we see Valdez throw a combination. He's been throwing all night. Straight right, left hand, straight right. Gives Tamayo a nice angle where he has nowhere to turn, nowhere to throw. And the young fighter Valdez is out of harm's way.
CompuBox numbers through five rounds. Valdez has landed 119 out of 249. Tamayo 37 out of 237. So Valdez has landed 82 more punches while throwing only 12 more.
Jim, getting back to your point about the exhale, though, the grunt. When every punch is thrown with a similar force, ha, ha, ha. You know, Lomachenko wouldn't be able to do that because he'd have to, you know, they're coming in too quickly.
Right.
The speed and force of the punch has varied, and it helps recalibrate what his opponent is expecting and can lead to knockouts. Here, as Andre mentioned, he's in with a guy who knows what's coming. He knows how it's going to land. He can brace for it the same way every time.
These kind of fights for a young up-and-coming fighter, a young prospect, trying to get to contender status and eventually championship status. These are tough fights. You're fighting a veteran who's not necessarily trying to win rounds. They just want to try to land a big shot. And here you are trying to not only win, but look good doing it. You're opening yourself up, and once again, the veteran's just waiting. He's looking, and he's waiting for you to make a mistake to land a big shot. Tough times for young fighters, but this is what you have to go through.
So you feel extraordinary pressure, despite the fact that you know that you're supposed to be the better fighter and you're supposed to be able to win the fight. It's prefigured that way. That, in effect, maybe increases the pressure.
Exactly. This is, quote-unquote, the opponent's Super Bowl.
Right.
If he wins, he's the man. If you win, you're supposed to win. So the pressure's all on the prospect. But this is what he has to learn to deal with if he's going to be a champion one day.
Well, Tamayo's having a pretty good late second quarter, early third quarter of the game in that case, because while he's losing the rounds and taking a bit of a beating in the process, last couple rounds, boy, he's really... You know, he's found some holes in Valdez's defense.
Good shot from Tamayo right there, straight left.
And he got off to a 10-8 start because of what was ruled a knockdown at the end of round one when Oscar Valdez's foot wound up under the foot of Ruben Tamayo, and Tamayo was able to land a shot at that moment, which caused Valdez to go down.
And this is when veterans like to make their move. The fight starts at the sixth round, after the fifth round. This is when a fight really starts. So a veteran will take punishment, sort of wear you down, then slowly try to make his move. Let's see what happens here.
Tamayo, that's a low blow.
Last time. Keep him up. No more chances. All right? Let's go.
Tamayo's landed about a half dozen clean shots to the head in each of the last couple rounds. And again, Valdez just throws his fastball. He needs to mix in some changeups and off-speed pitches.
Valdez has only been past eight rounds one time.
And it's looking as though he's going to be going past eight rounds here, because for all the solid shots that Oscar Valdez has landed on Ruben Tamayo, he hasn't wobbled him. And Tamayo does not look to have been worn down yet.
All right, listen, son. Breathe. He's waiting. He's waiting to counter you. All right, you've got to be... Get up on your defense. You took notice. He's waiting for you to come in, yeah, to counter you, all right? So you gotta be very sharp on that aspect, all right? And then after your feint, you go in. You pop him. And then after that comes flex the waist, right? Or at least, come on, keep your guard up. Keep your guard up. I don't want to see you with your hands on your chest. Close up the guard and close your mouth. Good? Everything's going good. On the inside, you're good.
And there is young Felix Verdejo. You saw him on June 13 with a unanimous decision victory over Ivan Nahera in the theater at Madison Square Garden. That electrifying smile is likely to bond Felix Verdejo with audiences, particularly Puerto Rican fight fans, for years to come. He showed enormous skill in his fight against Nahera. Harold, how do you have it through six?
Jim, I got a virtual shutout. I've got it 5-1, 58-55, Oscar Valdez. You know, Jim, I love the way he hits him and then he turns. I mean, he's trying to turn Tamayo in the worst way. He'll bang him with a hard right hand, you see, and he turns him, you know? He's been doing that. It's sort of a little bit like Manny Pacquiao does, you know, or Manny Pacquiao tries to do. He hits you and he turns you. See, he gets in a nice right hand and he turns. The reason being is when Tamayo comes back, Valdez is not there. 5-1, Oscar Valdez.
Minutes to go in round 7 of a scheduled 10. Valdez doing the same thing that he's done the preceding 6 rounds, throwing hard shots, moving his feet very effectively, winning the rounds against Ruben Tamayo. Tamayo, just as he's done for 6 rounds, still there, taking everything, handling it pretty well, continuing to fire back.
Fights like this, I mentioned, not only kind of how impressed are you by this young prospect, but the other question is, since he's expected to win impressively, is how far away is he from challenging the top of the division? The top of the division at featherweight is Vasily Lomachenko, who'd be favored against a lot of fighters in any weight class were he campaigning in that weight class. You know, in a pound-for-pound sense, he's very impressive already.
In other words, what you're saying is he could be number one at 122. He could be number one at 130. He happens at this moment to be number one at 126.
At 126.
Hey, 1 point for low blow.
And here comes the point deduction. It should be academic.
From Tamayo.
1 point for low blow.
For low blows.
Arriba, okay? Hey,
but arriba. Also Nicholas Walters.
You okay? They hit you low. You all right? You don't want no break? All right. No revenge. Okay. Time in, let's go.
Walters is an excellent and powerful fighter. Valdez told us he admires Walters and his style. And so we're comparing, when you watch Valdez, him against that kind of standard. How far out, how often to the horizon is a matchup with those kind of experienced talents?
He's trying to put away Tamayo in this round, amping up the combinations. 2 5-punch combinations in a row, with every punch seeming to land, and still, Tamayo hangs in.
Great combinations, great punches, but not the right punches to get the veteran out of there.
And a lot of this fight has been in ones and one-twos, not as many extended combinations, not maybe as much body work as eventually, you know, you'd like to see him mix in.
You're saying yes, but you're not doing anything. But what? What? You're staying there, standing straight. Throw a lateral or go to the other side. What are you staying there? Wait for him to hit you. Come on, he's very fast, but you're more intelligent. You gotta go to the sides. Don't just stand there for him to hit you. Close your eyes. Yeah, you caught him good to the body, good. Keep touching him to the body. Keep turning him.
Tamayo's been warned multiple times from the ref. Here he goes again with a very, very low blow. Great call by the ref to take a point. Don't want to say it was intentional, but that was really low below the belt. Great call by the ref. You got to take a point in that situation.
CompuBox numbers in the 7th. Valdez, 31 out of 66. Tamayo, 7 out of 41. That's the highest number thrown and landed so far in the fight for Valdez, 31 out of 66. Virtually every one of these rounds has looked very much the same as Valdez continues to put a lot of leather on Tamayo and lands at an extremely high rate of accuracy. If there's one thing that sets young Oscar Valdez apart so far in his professional career, it is his accurate punching. He lands at an exceptionally high rate, regardless of the assortment of punches he's throwing.
Yeah, and I misspoke earlier when I said that Valdez had been past 8. He's only fought 8 rounds one time, so he's been here before but never passed the 8th round.
Good.
But even in the 8th, he looks like he's got plenty of energy. He's still throwing a lot of hard shots. Once again, would like him to throw some different kind of shots, maybe that he hasn't thrown up until this point. And like Max mentioned earlier, touch the veteran to the body. You haven't done that yet. You've hit him with everything to the head. Touch the body and see what happens. But he's clearly ahead. He's boxing really well up until this point.
Yeah, that Tamayo landed one good body shot in particular this round. The flip side of my criticism of Valdez, maybe not varying the force of his shots enough to make something happen unexpectedly against Tamayo, is, as you mentioned, Jim, when your connect percentage is really high, and every shot is being thrown with real force, you're damaging your opponent.
That's a second time. I will take
more your own hands.
You hear me? Keep them up. Yeah. Keep them up. Let's go.
Another low blow from Tamayo.
Another left hook upstairs for Oscar Valdez. Another straight right hand upstairs for Oscar Valdez. Crowd is oohing and eyeing at the shots that he's landing, but Tamayo has a Mexican chin.
Yeah, he didn't come to just get a check. Got to respect that from Tamayo. But even though Valdez hasn't knocked Tamayo out, down or out, you got to think about the health of Tamayo. These are the kind of fights that worry you sometimes when the fighter's taking so many shots to the head. Another low blow from Tamayo. And he hasn't gone down. It's the accumulative effect that you worry about with a fighter like this.
Tamayo's flirting with disqualification. I mean, logic tells us we'll get a second point deduction first. And maybe that would be enough to curb it. But he hasn't been able to stop himself from continuing to throw low blows.
And he has shown, I wouldn't say Valdez has ever been hurt in this fight, but he's felt Tamayo's power here and there, to the body and to the head.
But he's responded well.
He is. You can see his inclination when he gets hit is to hit back.
Which is what you want to see in a young fighter. Good body shot from the veteran. Valdez felt that for sure.
And that stopped a Valdez combination at that moment. After boxing tonight, tune in for a Real Sports replay. Catch an important update on the Real Sports story concerning the FIFA corruption scandal, with startling new allegations recently coming to light.
The hook to the body, but come on, flex your body in. You're standing straight up. Come on, we're just like we practice, all right? To the side and throw the uppercut. And you haven't done any of that. Okay. You've got to press him. Press him. He's not doing anything. Two rounds. We know those are intentional shots, but you've got to stay focused. Don't despair. Relax. You're boxing. You're boxing very nicely. You're moving yourself very nice. But tighten up the defense.
Ruben Tamayo from Ciudad Obregón in Sonora, Mexico.
Wait up.
Against Oscar Valdez, whose father lives and who hails from Nogales, Mexico. Valdez in the black trunks, Tamayo in the white with gold trim. You see Harold Letterman's unofficial scorecard, on which he has had Valdez winning every round since the first. And the first round is somewhat a distortion because what appeared to us to be a trip rather than a knockdown was ruled a knockdown by the referee, Ray Corona, and therefore Harold Letterman, following the rules of the game, scored it 10-8 for Tamayo, when in fact, had Valdez not been tripped and gone down at the end of the round, it would have been a 10-9 round for Valdez, and he would have a clean shutout going to this point in the fight. But the knockdown call made it interesting, at least for a little while.
Nice little bit of adversity for Valdez to have to deal with psychologically and overcome, and he overcame it in the next round. It wasn't a big deal.
And then eventually got back the point that he lost for the knockdown when Tamayo was penalized for low blows a couple of rounds ago by Corona.
Boxing, go ahead.
Well, he hasn't, you mentioned before, Andre, he hasn't been past eight. Here we are in the ninth. And Valdez, for the first time, is looking a little bit sloppy to me with some of those power shots.
Yeah, he's a little sloppy. But this is what it's about. This is a great learning experience for him. Sometimes we want young fighters to come out and wow us every time out. And we got to be patient and allow him to grow up sort of right before your eyes and figure it out on the job.
But what I mean is, here it is, sure enough, the ninth round's never been there before. And the way he's throwing the power shots looks like he's... Is that a psychological thing? You go into the round, I haven't been here before, and it plays on you?
Absolutely. The first time you fight 10, the first time you fight 12, in the back of your mind, even though you don't admit it, you think, how am I going to feel? So absolutely. But the next time, he won't feel this way.
There are other talented featherweights we have not mentioned in this discussion. Abner Mares, Gary Russell. They fall on the other side of a political dividing line. And at this point in time, it's difficult to foresee how Valdez would fight either of them because of that political divide. But if at some point at the future, in the future, the best all fight the best without political restrictions, those are two other members of the 126-pound weight class.
I mentioned the top-ranked fighters who vowed that there wouldn't be a problem making the fight. But the fact is Lomachenko already schooled Gary Russell Jr., who has improved since then. But Lomachenko pitched a virtual shutout against him and I think has proven himself decisively, clearly, to be the class of the division.
You'll certainly get no argument from me. I put him on the fight game pound-for-pound list after listening to Roy Jones extol his virtues the night of Mayweather-Pacquiao.
Ooh, good body shot again.
One round to go.
He's hurt. You're hurting him. He doesn't want anything else with you. He keeps going back when they try a counter. It goes to the side, but you know, I'm trying again. When I throw it across the shot, but it goes back, and I don't know what to do. I just stay there. We're winning easily. Easily, we're winning easily all around. The only thing that I don't want is for you to be distracted, all right? I tell you again, I repeat it again. This dude is looking for the counter shot, remember? Yeah. So work after your fake. Fake him, let him open up. When he opens up, hit him.
Round 10 of a scheduled 10. Oscar Valdez, rising prospect from Mexico, going 10 for the first time in his career. Landing hard shots to open the 10th round, just as he's done in every round up to this point. Another hard right hand for Valdez.
Gotta like this young prospect. First major exposure on HBO. Tough veteran in front of him. Felt his power to the body at times. Hasn't been able to knock him down. He's gunning for the knockout.
Better believe the veteran, Tamayo, still looking for that one shot. He's going to try to close the show and let the young fighter expend his energy. And on the second half of this round, he's going to try to close the show.
But that shows you Valdez has that thing in him that wants to please the crowd, that competitive thing where he wants to win decisively, where now it's a competition with himself. Can I get this guy out of here?
Oh, I like it. He could have easily cruised. I mean, his corner just told him he was way up. I mean, he is way up, and he's not fighting like he's way up.
No, and there's some, and there's some danger here, because what's coming back at him, he's felt at times.
No question Valdez has what it takes to be a champion one day. He has pedigree. He's got everything it takes. He just needs seasoning. Just be patient, let him get groomed, and let him get these kind of fights where he learns on the job.
Fast hands, educated feet. Seems to be pretty solid authoritative power, although not enough to get a knockout of Tamayo tonight. That's going to happen from time to time.
Tamayo's right eye now swollen.
Not a punishment Tamayo's taking tonight. It's just unbelievable.
Valdez. It takes remarkable stamina to throw every punch with all-out power the way Valdez has done throughout the fight.
Especially in the 10th round.
Valdez breathing through his mouth. 10th round, under a minute to go. Looking for the knockout. Every punch a bomb. With some urgency, as though he's behind in the fight in this round. And that's one of the ways to connect to your fans.
As of a week ago, we didn't know for certain that we were going to be showing Valdez on this card. Gets put onto the card more or less at the last minute, becomes the 1,000th fight in the history of HBO, and puts on a pretty interesting and entertaining show against Ruben Tamayo, trying with all his might in every round to knock Tamayo out and getting, for his trouble, just a whole lot of landed power shots in an excellent performance against a tough opponent.
Great finish by Valdez.
Yep, that's the way to close the show. He didn't get the knockout, but boy, he was gunning for it.
manager Frank Espinoza congratulating his fighter. Cut man Miguel Diaz, veteran of the sport, slipping between the ropes to take a look at the unmarked Oscar Valdez on the far side of the ring. California State Commission doctor getting a good look at Ruben Tamayo's right eye.
And Andre, you mentioned earlier there's a way to fight smarter, not always harder. And that does come with seasoning. But at this level, before he's had all of that seasoning, the effort is there, the intentions are there, the energy is there, and I think fans here appreciated it.
Absolutely. All right, let's take a look, excuse me a second, Andre. Let's take another look at the knockdown at the end of round one. Take us through what happened here, Andre.
Once again, we see Tamayo land a shot, definitely tripped Valdez. The referee doesn't have the luxury of a replay, so he called it the way he called it. It was a slip, and the young fighter responded the way he was supposed to respond.
And now ring announcer Lupe Contreras is standing by with the official results in his hands. And as we see Tamayo getting the ice on his right eye, let's go to Lupe Contreras for the official result.
Ladies and gentlemen, after completing the scheduled 10 rounds here at the StubHub Center, we consult the official scorecard to determine a winner. Judges Cantu and Taylor turn in identical scores of 98 to 90. And Judge Young scores it 99 to 90, all in favor of the winner. By way of unanimous decision, still undefeated, Oscar Valdez.
So Valdez makes his HBO debut and shows you a little bit of what he's got. We look forward to seeing him in the future. Final CompuBox numbers will show you the degree to which Valdez completely dominated the fight, landing nearly three times as many punches as Tamayo, throwing 57 more and landing at a 42% connect percentage, which is exceptionally high.